Very good morning, friends. And today we are on the day four, and we are in the session four of the module one of the analog electronics course. So the learning objective for session four would be here in today's session, you will gain an understanding on the different transistor models. Okay, we refer it to as the large signal model and the small signal model. Okay, so you will have understanding of, and we'll also be able to differentiate between the two models, and we will also discuss on the signal equivalent circuit models, transistor models, and we will also see how the BJT circuits are represented in DC, and we will also discuss on the transistor breakdown and temperature effects, that is how the beta DC and the temperature has an effect on the current, and what is the influence on the collector current. Okay. So this is about the learning objective for the session four. So talking about the transistor circuit models, transistor models are used for almost all modern electronic design works. Analog circuit simulators such as SPICE use models to predict the behavior of a design. Most design work is related to integrated circuit design, which has a very large tooling cost, primarily for the photo mask used to create the device. And there is a large economic incentive to get the design working without any iterations. Complete and accurate models allow a large percentage of the design to work the first time. So modern circuits are usually very complex, and the performance of such circuit is difficult to predict without accurate computer models, including, but it is not limited to models of the devices used. So the device models include effect of transistor layout, like the width, length, proximity to other devices, transient and DC current voltage characteristics, and then you have the parasitic device capacitance, resistance, inductance, time delay, right? And interdigitization, and we have the proximity to other devices, transient and DC current voltage characteristics, parasitic device capacitance, resistance, inductance, time delay, and temperature effect. Okay, and when it comes to the transistor circuit model, we categorize them as large signal models and small signal models. Okay, or we normally the large signal transistor models fall into, we also refer it to as the nonlinear model, and we have three types here. In large signal nonlinear model, you have the physical and empirical model. And so the difference between the physical model and the empirical model is the physical models are based upon the device physics, and it is again based on the approximate modeling of the physical phenomena within the transistor. So parameters within these models are based upon the physical property, such as the oxide thickness, substrate doping concentration, carrier mobility, and in past these models are very extensively they're used extensively, but the complexity of the modern devices make them inadequate for quantitative designs, and they find their most place in the hand analysis, that is at the conceptual stage of the circuit design. For example, it could be a simplified estimates of the signal swing limitations. Okay, and then we have the empirical model, and this type of model is entirely based upon the curve fitting. Okay, whatever function and the parameter values most adequately fit measured data to enable simulation of the transistor operation. So unlike a physical model, the parameter in an empirical model need to have no fundamental basis, and it will depend on the fitting procedures used to find them. And the fitting procedure is the key to success of these modules. If they are not to be used to extrapolate to the design lying outside the range of the data to which the models were originally fitted, such extrapolation is a hope of such models, but it is not fully realized so far. And then we have the physical and empirical model, or the large signal actually affects the operating point, as well as that the elements are non-linear and the circuit can be limited by power supply values to avoid variation in the operating point. And then we have the small signal or the linear modules, and they are used to evaluate the stability, gain, noise, bandwidth, and both in the conceptual stage of the circuit, that is to decide between the alternative design ideas before the computer simulation is needed and you are using. Okay, so a small signal model is generated by taking derivatives of the current voltage curves about a bias point or the Q point. As long as the signal is small relatively to the non-linearity of the device, the derivatives do not vary significantly and can be treated as a standard linear circuit element. An advantage of the small signal models is then can be solved directly. It can be solved directly. So small signals or the linear models are used to evaluate. You need to have in mind that they are used to evaluate the stability, gain, noise, and bandwidth. Okay, so let's see the large signal. So let's try to understand or the equivalent circuit, large signal equivalent circuit model. Okay, so here in the slide, you can see the first order model for the operation of, this is for the operation of an NPN transistor in the active mode. Okay, we have considered the active mode. And basically the forward bias voltage, VBE, okay? The forward bias voltage, VBE, causes an exponentially related current, IC. Okay, here, IC, to flow in the collector terminal. The collector current, IC, is independent of the value of the collector voltage as long as the collector base junction remains reverse biased. That is, VCB is greater than or equal to zero. Thus, in active mode, the collector terminal behaves as an ideal constant current source, where the current of or where the value of the current is determined by VBE. The base current IB is a factor of 1 by beta of the collector current. And the emitter current is equal to IC, okay, or is equal to the collector current, or the sum of the collector current and the base current. Since IB is much smaller than IC, that is beta to be very greater than 1, IC is almost equal to, emitter current is almost equal to the collector current IC. More precisely, the current collector current is a fraction of alpha of the emitter current, and alpha is a very small quantity, which is almost equal to 1. Okay, so the first order model of the transistor operation in the active mode is what we see here. And here, if we observe, you have the diode DE, which has a current ISC. Okay, so ISC is equal to IS by alpha, right? And this provides a current IE related to VBE. According, and why? Because the forward bias voltage VBE causes an exponential current IC, and IC is independent of the collector voltage as long as the collector base junction remains reverse biased. So VCB should be greater than or equal to zero. And so in active mode, the collector terminal behaves as a constant current source. Okay. And the current of the collector controlled source, which is equal to the collector current, is controlled by VBE according to the exponential relationship indicated. That is, you have ISE to the power VBE. Or IEC equal to IC is equal to ISE power VBE by VT. Okay, because of this relationship, the model is in essence a non-linear voltage controlled current source. Okay, and it can be converted to a current controlled current source by expressing the current of the controlled source as alpha times IE. Okay. And the model is also a and this model will also be a non-linear because of the exponential relationship of the current IE through the diode DE and the voltage VBE. Right? Okay, so you can represent the circuit as alpha. Okay, so we are replacing IESVE power VBE by VT as in this circuit. So alpha into IE and the rest remains the same. Okay, so the model represents a non-linear current controlled current source, and the current source current is expressed, or the source current is expressed as alpha times IE. Okay. And again, so this is also a nonlinear model because VBE causes exponential current IC, and the current gain is alpha, which is called as the common base current gain. Okay. And so from this model, okay, from the two slides that we have observed, or the two models that we have seen now, the transistor can be used as a two-port network with the input port situated between the emitter and base, and the output port between the collector and the base. That is, the base is the common terminal. Okay. And then the current gain observed is equal to alpha, and this current gain is also called as, or it can be called as, the common base current gain, common base current gain, or alpha. Okay. And this can also be represented using the other models in the following slide. We will see. Okay, so these are the two other models. The first one is the voltage controlled current source, and the second, what you see. Okay, so this is the voltage controlled current source, and this represents the current controlled current source. Okay, so here. This is used to represent the operation of the BJT, and here the diode DB conducts the base current, and thus the current scale factor is IS by beta, resulting in which results in the IB VBE character relationship, or the characteristics can be drawn. So by simply expressing the collector current beta IB, okay, the collector current beta IB, current controlled current source model can be shown. Okay, that is, this can be collector current replaced by beta IB. So you can represent it as a current controlled current source. So if we observe, the transistor is used as a two-port network with the input port between the base and the emitter, okay, and the output port between collector and the emitter, okay, and and the current gain observed is equal to beta, and this is called as, so current gain is beta, which is the which is called as the common emitter current gain, and since there is no limitation on the size of VBE, the model are referred to as the large signal model. Okay, so this is the large signal equivalent circuit model for the transistor. And now let's see how to represent the BJT circuit in the DC, or the conditions and models of BJT in various operating modes, that is in the active mode, the saturation mode, and the cutoff mode. Okay, and now we consider the BJT circuit. Okay, here what we have done is we have considered the BJT circuit by applying only the DC voltages are applied here. Okay, and we simply model it with VBE of the conducting transistor is 0.7 volts and VCE of a standard VCE of a saturated transistor is of 0.2 volts. And we also neglect the early effect. Okay. And here, the circuit, what exactly we plan to show here is to better models can also be used, and usually we are trying to achieve the performance at the expense of speed of analysis, and more importantly, it could be it could also impede the circuit designer's ability to gain insight regarding the circuit behavior. Okay, and accurate results using elaborate models can be obtained using the circuit simulation with the help of SPICE, and this is most always done in the final stage of the design, and certainly before the circuit fabrication. Okay, so so if you see the circuit and analyze, we get two questions in mind. One is, in which mode is the transistor operating? Because we are familiar with the transistor operation in three different modes: active, pass, saturation, and cutoff, right? And it was also discussed that for digital circuits, the cutoff and saturation modes are of importance, and for analog circuit, active mode is of importance, right? And if we quickly check the terminal voltages, it will indicate whether the transistor is cut off or it is conducting. So if it is conducting, we have to determine whether it is in the operating in the active mode or in the saturation mode. Okay, in some cases this can be obviously known, but in order to get a deeper understanding, okay, we need to determine by utilizing some of the procedures that we discuss now. Okay, so assume that the transistor is operating in the active mode, and proceed to discuss the various voltages and current that corresponds, and then we check for the consistency of the result with the assumption of the active mode of operation, that is when VCB, okay, that is the collector base voltage across the collector base of the NPN transistor is greater than minus 0.4 volt, or VCB of a PNP transistor is lower than 0.4 volt. And if the answer is yes, then our our task is complete. Else, we need to assume that the saturation mode, we need to assume that the saturation mode of operation, and proceed to determine the current and voltage, and then check for consistency of the result with the assumption of the saturation mode of operation. So here, let's first usually we need to compute the ratios of IC by IB, and then verify that it is lower than the transistor beta. Okay, so if beta forced is less than, okay, so sorry. So in the cutoff mode, you see that the emitter base junction is reverse biased, and collector base junction is reverse biased. And for NPN, VBC should be less than 0.4 and VBE should be less than 0.5. Okay. And similarly here for a PNP transistor, VCB should be less than 0.4 and VEB should be less than 0.5. Okay. So this is the condition that you have to check. And then for the active mode, again, your emitter base junction is forward bias, collector base junction is reverse bias. VBC is less than 0.4 and VBE is approximately 0.7 volts for NPN. And for a PNP, this should be less than, VCB should be less than 0.4 and VEB should be approximately 0.7. Okay, and for saturation mode, VBC for NPN transistor should be 0.5 volts and VBE should be approximately 0.7 volts. And for PNP transistor, VCB, that is voltage across the collector base, should be approximately 0.5 volts and the voltage across the emitter base should be approximately 0.7 volts. And VCE sat should be, VEC sat should be, that is voltage across the emitter and the collector. Saturation should be approximately 0.2 volts. Okay. And here for active region, this should be VCE should be greater than 0.3 and VEC should be greater than 0.3 volts. Okay. So this is, these are the conditions that you need to check. So here, once you verify or test in the different operating, the results are verified in the different operating modes. The test is usually, again, we also need to compute the beta, that is the ratio of IC by IB, and verify if it is lower than the transistor beta. Okay, so beta force should be less than beta. And since beta for a given transistor type varies over a wide range, one must use the lowest specified beta for the when you are testing. Okay, and note that the order of these assumptions are can be reversed also. Okay, and we can have the operation of the BJT in these three possible modes. Okay, and now let's discuss about the breakdown voltages. So the basic limitation, okay, the basic limitation of a maximum of the maximum voltage in a transistor is same as that in a PN junction diode. However, the voltage breakdown depends not only on the nature of the junction involved, but also on the external circuit arrangement. So in a common base configuration, the maximum voltage between the collector and the base with the emitter open, the breakdown voltage or VCBO is determined by an avalanche breakdown voltage of the collector base junction. And common emitter configuration, the maximum voltage between the collector and emitter with the base open, VCEO can be much smaller than VCBO. Okay. So if we the maximum voltage that is applied for a BJT is limited by the emitter base junction and the collector base junction, and breakdown voltage effects that follow the avalanche multiplication mechanism that we discussed in the previous session. Okay, and if we consider the common base configuration, the ICVC VO characteristics indicate ICVC B characteristics indicate that that for IE equal to zero, the emitter open circuited and the collector base junction breaks down at the voltage denoted by BVCO, and IE is greater than zero, breakdown occurs at voltage smaller than BVCO. And typically for a discrete BJT, BVCO, VCBO is greater than 50 volts. And now if we consider for the common emitter characteristics as shown in the diagram here, okay, or the figure shown in the slide, the breakdown voltage occurs at the voltage BVCO, And although the breakdown is still of the Avalanche type, the effect of the characteristics are more complex than that of the common base configuration. The BVCEO is sometimes referred to as the sustaining voltage. Okay, and the breakdown of the collector base junction is in either the common base or the common emitter configuration is not destructive as long as the power dissipated in the device is kept within the safe limit. This, however, is not the case with the breakdown of the emitter base junction. The emitter base junction breaks down in an avalanche manner at the voltage BVCBO. Much smaller than BVC BVC VCBO, and typically EBO is in the range of 6 volts to 8 volts, and the breakdown is destructive in the sense that the beta of the transistor is permanently reduced, and this does not prevent the use of the emitter base junction as a zero or as a Zener diode and to generate the reference voltage in the integrated circuit design. And in applications, one is not concerned with the beta degradation effect, and a circuit arrangement to prevent the emitter base junction breakdown in IC amplifier can also be designed. Okay, and the transistor breakdown and maximum allowable power dissipation are important parameters when you are designing the power amplifiers. Okay, and also we will see what about the dependency of temperature and beta. Okay, so here we see the characteristics curve of the dependency of beta on temperature, and the fact that beta increases with temperature. Okay, can lead to a serious problem in transistor that operate at large power levels. Okay, and beta, as we know, refers to the transistor common emitter DC current gain, and is a constant for a given transistor. And if beta depends on the DC current or at which the temperature is the transistor is operating, as and the physical process that give rise to this dependency are beyond the scope of our discussion here, and the current range over which beta is highest, and normally one arranges to arranges to operate the transistor at a current gain with within the range. Okay, and so this is about the effect of temperature effect on the transistor, and so this completes our session, the fourth lecture, and let's test your understanding on the previous four sessions, including the present one. So in a BJT, if the collector base junction is reverse biased and the base emitter junction is forward biased, which region is the BJT operating in? Okay, whether it is the saturation region, active region, cutoff region, reverse active region. Okay. And then which of the following correctly determines the relation between alpha and beta? Whether it is beta is equal to alpha by 1 minus alpha, alpha is beta by 1 minus alpha, or beta is equal to 1 alpha by 1 minus beta, or beta is equal to alpha into 1 minus beta. Okay. So you need to... Okay. And then the next question is IC. Value of IC is precisely zero when the value of IE is zero. Is this true or false? And for a common emitter configuration, which of the following is correct relationship? Okay, whether IC is less than IE, IC is equal to beta times IB, IC is equal to alpha IE, or IC is IE. Okay, so the correct answer, if you are able to get the correct answers, we are happy with your understanding, and we end the current session, the lecture 4, we end here, and let's meet next session 5, where we will exclusively discuss on transistor biasing. Thank you.